Don Monty, the CEO of Renaissance Downtowns. So as, did everyone hear okay if I stood up?
Nope, I can hear you fine.
Yes. So we were invited here tonight to give a presentation. We're happy to be here. This is a room and most of the faces that we're very familiar with. I've given lots of presentations over the last 4 years. So very quickly, I'll run through some of the details of the project on the large scale and then get into the details of the individual sites. This project started, I think, through the mayor's initiative and working with the community in 2006. As they went through that, they did a comprehensive plan update, which was completed in 2008. We signed our master development agreement in 2012 with the village. In July 2012, the new zoning and SEAKER was adopted. The SEAKER is State Environmental Quality Review, for anyone who isn't familiar with the acronym. In July 2013, we submitted our first site plan. That took 6 months or so worth of engineering review by the village engineers, the village environmental consultants, as well as the county engineers to go through that process. That was approved by the planning board in November of 2014. And in December 2014, the North Main Street site plan was submitted to begin the review process with the village of Hempstead engineers and consultants. So, quickly about the development area. All of the zoning right now on the underlying property is zoned for business B. That business B zoning allows up to around 20 million square feet of commercial space to be built right now. And that pre-existed the new zoning, and it still exists today. So commercial development can happen anytime they're under the old zoning. From private property owners, all within the downtown, all the way up to the Garden City Quarter. The new zoning is the downtown overlay zone, and that's optional. So the optional zoning allows a property owner to opt in and use different uses than what's allowed under business B. So we went through that process. Not everybody has to use that zoning. If you want to use the underlying zoning, everybody's ready to do so. And that's up to the individual property owner that wants to move forward. So the overlay zone only exists in the downtown, and that's very important. And that downtown is defined by maps, and it really goes from Franklin to Main Street. The apartment buildings on Washington and the apartment buildings in Terrace are not part of the overlay zone. They don't have anything to do with it. They're not affected by the zoning. And so they're not really part of the overall project conversation. And that leads me to the development rights with the master developer. We do have the right to develop, to buy and develop the land that the village owns in the development area, which is the core of the downtown. If there's a building on it, the village has to agree that we replace that building to their satisfaction and some specifications. And that has to be done before we can take ownership of the property. So if the building department was going to move, they'd have to move into a new space before we were allowed to take ownership of the building department's building. So that's the process that was set up, and that's the process that will continue. But that's really at the option of the village, the mayor, and the trustees. There's been a lot of talk about where we chose to start the development first. You'll see in a moment that we chose to start on the corner of Washington and Front Street. When we started this, and as we went through it more recently, it came to our attention that there was an unrecorded lease against the five main parking lots surrounding the transit hub. So all of the village-owned property in the North Main Street area. we have to work through that with the Long Island Railroad to get the property released. The worst part about the 99-year lease, if we could wait that long, they have an automatic renewal of another 99 years. So it turns into 198-year lease. We're working through that. We're working with village attorneys, our own attorneys, working hand-in-hand with the railroad to get that released. If you're wondering, I think there's still 80-something years left on the first portion of the lease. So that's not in anyone's time frame here to be reasonable to go about with the development there. Since they control the property, we're working with them. And you'll see for the North Main Street site plan, we got them to release certain rights on certain parcels. Not the two right at the train station, but the one parcel that's the North Main Street site plan that was submitted in December is inclusive of one of the parking lots that they previously controlled, that they've agreed to give up control over to allow the development to go forward. And there's been a lot of talk about the rights of the master developer and the MDA. And just to be clear, the New York court system has upheld the legitimacy of the contracts and the process twice through one lawsuit and a subsequent appeal with very strong decisions that everything has been set up the way it needs to be to follow the rules and follow the law of New York State. What's very important is through the process of this project, we've achieved $30 million in sewer funding for sewer improvements for the village. Now, we didn't do this alone. There are many, many bodies involved. Your elected officials that have unfortunately since left, like Legislator Troiano was very instrumental in this. Working with the village, the village working with the state, we got $5 million worth of funding from the state, which is the second largest award since the governor put in their new grant program. The only other one that beat Hempstead was Wyandanch. And Wyandanch continues to get more and more money. I think they're around $50 million now, looking for another $100 million or so for additional infrastructure improvements. But they broke ground. They're building. So as they build, they're going to get more consideration from the state for additional funding. This $30 million is going directly into your sewer system improvements in the downtown and for the rest of the village. And the improvements that are being contemplated here are actually going to improve all of the sewage in all of the village, the entire 11550. That is actually, those construction documents are supposed to be finished by the county in March. So that's exciting. That means they're ready to go. It's in the capital plan. Your legislators have fought for that. And I think it's a very important part of how this overall project is moving forward. And now it's time to build. As I said, we got our first site approved. As we start building, we really are going to be first in line for additional infrastructure dollars. We know $30 million isn't going to cut it. We have to look at other infrastructure issues in the village, including parking, water distribution and pressure, and all of those things that come along, not just with this project, because this project isn't causing the problem, but it's trying to solve the issues that exist today and that have been around for a while. Phase one. This first building, it's on the corner of Washington, going north-south on Front Street. It's known as Parking Field 1. There's a structured parking garage there that will remain. The surface parking lot now is used by meter-paying patrons as well as the town of Hempstead employees. All of those will be moved into the parking garage. They'll be given, the town and I should get additional spaces from what they have now. Now, the site itself qualified to go to 10 stories, 8 stories if it was residential. We didn't do that. We chose to do a 5-story building. So we're underneath the maximum density allowed on the building. And here's the overhead photograph of the site. You can see the parking garage, which will remain intact and in place. We'll be doing a lot of improvements to the parking garage for lighting, safety, and control systems. I'm sure you all know the site well, but here's some images of the existing conditions. here's the site plan. So that's where the building is going. You can see the red outline here. This is the existing parking garage. So the building will sit to the east of that parking garage, running along the corner of Washington. Here's a 3D image rendering of what the building looks like on site. And then here's the floor plan of the building, and it shows the access to and from. We're increasing the number of surface parking. A lot of the surface parking will remain handicapped. In fact, there's more handicapped spaces in the new plan than there were before. With the Helen Keller building there and some other uses in the surrounding area, we needed to increase the number of accessible spaces on the ground. And there's additional meter parking on the ground for patronage use. Unfortunately, a lot of us use it for the Massachusetts County Courthouse to pay for traffic tickets, but you know, more and more there'll be additional activity on Main Street and more meters are important. Here's a rendering image of the facade of the building. This is as if we're standing on Washington Street. So this is what it will look like running up Washington Street. You can see there's actually doors and stoops on the ground level. So the entrances to the apartments on the ground level will have an entrance from the hallway that's completely ADA accessible, as well as your own entrance to the street. This helps activate the street, make sure it's safer so people are using their front door, and it also allows the streetscape to be used for the patrons that are living on that streetscape. Some of the materials we're looking to use include dark brick bases, some really interesting metal panels for the siding, which you don't really see on residential buildings. It gives it a much kind of sharper, cleaner look. The amenity space is being designed with windows and frontages, and the interior courtyards with sitting areas and seating areas for people to use. So the next part of this is our planning phases for 2015. Here's an overhead photograph of the downtown of the village. Here is Main Street here. This is the train station and the bus station to give you orientation. This is the phase one site. So this is the phase one site. The Mill Creek building, Metro 303, is up here at the top of the screen, so it gives you some more orientation as to where we are in the downtown. This is the roof of the county courthouse right there. So the site plan that was submitted in December is on the corner of Bedell and Main Street. It runs along Main Street, and it's programmed to have 28,000 square feet of Main Street retail, with some of it being on Bedell on the side street, and residential above that. So that's the next site plan that was submitted. We're beginning the review process with the village, so we have to go through the process with the engineers and the environmental consultants in order to do this. Now, as I said earlier, the last one took about 16 months. We expect this to take a good deal shorter period of time, because now that everybody's gone through it and we can go through this process, it can move a little bit faster. But the engineering and environmental review takes some time to go through. So here is a picture of the site now. This is the corner of Bedell, and this is Main Street facing south. So you can see the Rivoli building here to the south on the right-hand side, and this is the Dell bus parking lot where the buses park today. So this is a rendering of what that building will look like. Again, retail on the ground floor, residential above, right on the corner of Bedell and Main. So the next site plan we're working on is on across the street from that, on Main Street. The property is owned by it's the Mack Markowitz dealership. Does everybody know the Mack Markowitz dealership? Yeah. So that's the one that's been boarded up for a decade, maybe probably longer, along with the lot that the building that the bus is parked on. Again, this is on either side of Bedell. There'll be buildings on either side of Bedell. The entrance into the parking lot at the train station will remain open. This again is going to be mixed use. Now here's some images of existing conditions here on the left-hand side. So that's what we're looking at for this site. You can see Mack Markowitz coming up here, and this is what it looks like now. It's all boarded up. They try and keep it boarded up. People often break into it. They dump on the site. I know they're actually, I think, fined about $600 recently because somebody dumped a bunch of mattresses and garbage on the site. Not the owners, but they easily clean it up. And then it gets to Bedell Street, and again, we're facing south and heading south in a southerly direction. And this is the parking lot where the buses are parked. So here's a rendering of what it'll look like across the street. This is the Bedell and North Main Street that was submitted, and this is a site that we're working on now. And there's the renderings. Again, mixed use. So retail on the ground floor, residential above. So some other sites that we're working on. This site along Denton Green. And this is up between Fulton, Hempstead Turnpike, and Nichols. So this is looking down the street. The building will come out to the street with some retail and storefront on the side streets. It's not on Main Street, so there won't be retail on Main Street, but it'll be on side streets. And it'll fill in that space behind this building, which he's owned by Sam Glass. He owns a number of the existing buildings in the area. So this is a site down to the south that we're working on. And here's the picture of the parking lot. Now we are facing east. So this is Main Street. This is right across, essentially, from the Mental Health Association of Nassau County. Bebop Bagels is right over here. And this is municipal parking now. The parking obviously needs to be replaced, so all the store owners and patrons that use those stores now, including the B&T grocer and the other buildings and the office buildings in the area, including 250 Fulton, will continue to have parking. And here's a rendering of the same shot, as if we were standing in the same location on the site. The interior of the site will have pedestrian walls, some vehicular access, retail and restaurants facing in with residential above. There'll also be retail facing to Front Street and Fulton. So there'll be essentially five sides worth of retail. There'll also be retail that fronts the retail rear of Bebop Bagels and the children's store and VIP. So they have their rear storefronts against the parking lot. They'll keep that. There'll be a street there. There'll be other retail framing that. Adding to all of the action going down on Main Street. Another rendering of what that might look like from Front Street. Unfortunately, we're facing the rear of Staples and Home Goods and the tool place, but you know, we think we can still activate that street and really make that a great viable place, even though the unfortunate strip mall is. So those are what we showed you. Some other phases that we're looking at include office, medical office, and additional residential, hotel sites, and other development sites that we're working with the village now to go through the planning and appraisal process. But you know, I wanted to show you the ones that we're working on right now. We can't develop them all at the same time.
Of the community. We held a series of meetings with the community. Many of those meetings was packed out. We listened to what everybody had to say, and we carved out a framework and presented it to the village, and then the village did what they needed to do in terms of working with the developer. Since that time, and since I've already been working with the community to help individual find jobs, they appointed me to be the consultant to make sure the 25% of those jobs that they promised the community would in fact get those jobs. And that has been my primary focus, to make sure that we are preparing and bringing men and women in to prepare them so that when they start building, these guys and women will not be left out of those opportunities. In addition to that, I've been working with Crescent, even bringing them up to speed because they came up a little bit late in terms of making sure that the local community have an opportunity to get some contracts, because I believe that that'll translate into us getting some meaningful jobs. In fact, I work with a gentleman who's here now. He worked over at the charter school and was able to help me to get 17 people some work on one job site. And we appreciate it. Armstrong, you can stand up. He himself gave 17 people jobs. Somebody asked me a question, and let me answer that right off the top. Somebody asked me a question. When these people go to work, are they going to get on those jobs and then 2 weeks later or 3 weeks later going to lose those jobs? Dave Hubbard, how long you been with me?
5 years.
Uh-huh. And even my son worked on the Twin Oaks site. From the Twin Oaks site, he worked on, and even in Westbury, getting meaningful employment. And then he worked over on the Linden Knolls, and now he's working to help other people have an opportunity to go to work. I also keep a track record of all the people that come into my office looking for jobs. Every single person come in there, we have their track record. There are over 1,200 men in this local area that are looking to go to work. I'm not having the argument about whether or not this is an ideal concept in terms of building. My argument is, if they're going to build in these community, we should have first option and first opportunity to go to work. And that's has been my primary focus. We took a lot of guys and put them to work on various other sites already. We even worked with Dakota Movement, with some of those people, individuals, helping them and putting them to work. And a lot of these men are going on to work in the city, and they can't wait. They can't wait for the opportunity to go to work. They're not concerned about a whole lot of issues. They know that they need to feed their families. And many of the men and women out here are suffering, packing up, living in their family houses on the floor, all of those different kinds of things, because they don't have an opportunity. And let me just say one other thing. I have did the research. The village of Hempstead has the largest unemployment rate in all of Nassau County. And it just so happened that it's predominantly African American and Hispanic. We need the opportunity for us to go to work. And I'm not a fan of welfare and all of that. If I'm good, I'm strong enough to work, I should be able to work and given the opportunity to work. Now, basically, if you have anybody that is interested in being a part of the Renaissance Project in terms of going to work, my son is right over there. You can come to my office at any time. We will plug you into the system. We have already been taking our own resources and getting certain men training. And there are many of these guys that are already ready, willing, and able to go to work. That's taking them off the street corner so that when you walk down going home from your job and stuff like that, you don't have somebody standing on the street corner in a desperate way looking to do what he needs to do to get paid, if you know what I mean. That's basically all that I have to say about that.
Okay, we'll start questions.
Yeah, I'd just like to bring one additional point out. We have had a number of meetings with the new president of the school board, Lamont Johnson, and one of the things that is sometimes overlooked in the community benefits agreement, which I think is extremely important, is that not only are we looking to involve the community in construction work, but for the first time anywhere that we know of in the country, we have agreed to a mandate that not only during construction will there be work for Hempstead residents, but permanent jobs, careers after buildings are built, are baked into the zoning code. By that I mean, if a new company moves in and they bring in a certain number of employees with them, well, you can't expect them to lay anybody off. But let's say a company comes in with 100 employees in an office building that's being built. What they have to sign as part of their lease is that there's a 25% hiring goal for permanent jobs on any new hires that they get. Never been done anywhere before. So what we want to do is work with the school board, and I've committed resources to the school board to do nothing but help improve the graduation rate in Hempstead schools. And We think as a private developer that we can bring something to the table that will encourage young men and women to stay in school. But this permanent hiring component is something that we think has never been done before and will survive when construction is done. This is in perpetuity.
Goes to Reverend Benjamin. No. Let me read this one first since he talked about the school. What is the plan to support the school district with the influx of children and the overcrowding? Who wants to answer that?
I think that the CEQA study, which was an exhaustive study, and I think that this actually dates back to July of 2012, but this was a year-long process. And what the ultimate conclusion was, that based on the type of housing that's being provided in the village, essentially it's for young people and for empty nesters, that school-age children, and this was proven in the CEQA document, that ultimately the benefits to the school will be far greater than any impact that might occur from the minimal number of students that will be created. But again, you don't have to take our word for it. That is all available in a very voluminous document that was exhaustively studied and ultimately adopted.
Thank you. This question is to Reverend Benjamin. Is Mr. Armstrong the businessman that did not get paid for the construction job that he finished?
Again, those are not questions that I'm willing to answer. My question, my relationship with Mr. Armstrong was, he worked on a site. I asked him to give the people an opportunity to go to work, and he did. Now, you want to talk to him, you want to talk to his lawyer, you want to talk to anybody else, that's up to you. My statement, again, let me repeat it, was to get some individual an opportunity to go to work. And he was able to employ 17 people. Is that right, Mr. Armstrong?
Yes, that's right.
The next question. The $30 million sewer funding, where did this funding come from? Where's the infrastructure funding? Are the jobs permanent or temporary? One sec. The person who asked this question is, when you're asking about the jobs, were they permanent or temporary, which jobs are you talking about? The jobs Benjamin are talking about, or the sewer jobs?
I'm talking about the jobs that he's
The community benefits agreement lasts for the entire duration of the construction project. Right now, we're anticipating the build out between 8 and 10 years. So this community benefits agreement is going to ride that full 8 to 10 years. And then it will continue once construction is complete, and it will start when the first building is complete, with employment of local people for permanent jobs once the buildings are built.
Once the buildings are built, how are they going to generate permanent jobs from that?
So the tenants of the buildings are required to perform by the same zoning requirements. So if you own a restaurant or a tax accountant firm, an H&R Block, or an insurance company, and you occupy the space on the ground floor on the corner of Bedell and Main Street, and you're hiring people, you have to conform to the same hiring requirements because it's in the zoning code and it rides with the deed of the property. So that's how those buildings will actually provide the jobs. The building itself will have some jobs for security and maintenance and upkeep and turnover and that type of thing. But the tenants have to abide by the same law.
The CEQA document, which again, I think we would love to, first of all, for informational purposes, those of you that might be hearing a lot of this for the first time tonight, I can promise you that all you have to do at the end of this evening is give us your name, and we will be happy to meet with you in smaller groups to review in detail these documents. But CEQA documents showed over a 10-year period, 12,000 construction job years. Now, what that means is 10 years, 1,200 jobs per year. It also called for 3,500 permanent jobs to be created by this downtown redevelopment. This is an absolute win-win for everyone. So all we're saying is that I don't expect you to accept what I'm saying. I just ask you to hear it and then please make yourself available, we will, to sit down so we can show you that the facts that this whole approval was based on. And one other thing that's very important, phase one, were it not, and I think Sean mentioned this, but this is extremely important, that the sewer problem, as much as we all want to see other development take place by the train station, I think Sean adequately explained that we have that area encumbered by a 99-year lease, but yet we are working through this, and I say that because the railroad was actually kind enough in our discussions with them to release certain property that they know is not being used now. But were it not for phase one in the location that it's at, having come before Nassau County for approval, you would not have seen $5 million and $25 million, meaning that no one is giving infrastructure money to communities that are not developing. They are only giving infrastructure money to communities that are developing. Wyandanche is a perfect example. They keep getting 5 million, 6 million, 10 million. And why? Because they are moving forward with economic development. And they don't have a community benefits agreement, and they don't have the other things in place that your village has enacted, which I think is a tremendous asset to everyone. So time to move forward.
Yes. Sewer infrastructure improvements is from New York State, the federal government, and the county.
Excuse me?
The funding for the sewer improvements is from New York State, the federal government, and the county.
So that's the taxpayer. Because it's not coming out of their pockets. Because the taxpayer's money, right?
It's the whole country's taxpayer money. A lot of it came from FEMA. It's not village tax money.
It's some village.
Right.
Probably most of village tax money.
But it's, no, it can't be mostly village taxes. It's a lot of the FEMA. A lot of the funding went through the FEMA capital improvement plan associated with improvements for Sandy that would most benefit the region. So the development here in the downtown for the village is actually significantly improving the lives of people all the way down the line within the sewer system. And so those improvements are improving conditions in Baldwin and going to do a lot of good for the area. It's also going to help reduce a lot of the flooding on the creek culvert that runs along Clinton behind the Housing Authority by taking a lot of that excess water and getting that out of the sewer system. Because that's the main issue with all the flooding, it's the main issue with the backing up of sewage in people's homes. So that issue will then be removed, and the $5 million from the state that was awarded in a grant is given to improve sewer pipes in the downtown specifically. Now, you're right, it is taxpayers' money, but the state and the federal government would have that money regardless of giving it to you. So they could give it to Wyandanche. They've given a whole lot of it to Ronkonkoma. They've given a lot of it to other communities that aren't like Hempstead, and they've been doing it for a long time. They've now decided to put the money in Hempstead. You would have paid the money anyway. They had the money anyway. And so they've chosen to not spend it somewhere else. They've chosen to spend it here. And I think that's a very important thing for the village to have gotten on the radar, because for a very long time, the village has been asking for this money. And I know other people have been doing a great job of getting money also. I think earlier, at the end of last year, there was an announcement that the deputy speaker worked to get $1.5 million worth of additional sewer money. Was it $1.5 million? I don't know. A million. So there's a lot going on, that a lot of people are bringing these things to the table.
Thank you. Just in case anybody missed it, as I said before, all of us are residents. I'm not a part of Renaissance. in order for everybody to hear and understand, you must be respectful to the person that's next to you. We can't debate with one person or two people all night because none of these questions will be read. We do the forum this way so that everybody gets a clear understanding. There are no big I's and little U's in here. Everybody's a resident and everybody's concerned. I'd appreciate it if you want to say something, you can say whatever you want to say, but fill it out on a card, and maybe if there's no interruptions, I'll get a chance to read it. Thank you. Our next question. Does the developer anticipate receiving property tax abatements, subsidies, or incentives regarding the project from either the county, town, or the village?
So we don't know the answer to that question now. There's an appraisal process that we're going through. At the end of the appraisal process, we'll sit down with the village officials and the attorneys, and we'll see where we are and move forward from there. Now, as far as subsidies go, there's so many different types of subsidies, I'm not sure. Now, phase two of the project is planned to be a tiered mixed income development. And so tiered mixed income development is funded with certain resources that are grant money and is tax credit programs through New York State and the federal government and through home funds that are meant to develop attainably priced housing. So that tiered mixed income housing would be constructed with those development funds. Those are the state, the county, and the federal government programs that are supposed to be building it, just like Twin Oaks, the same type of program as the Twin Oaks development over on Hempstead Turnpike. They use tax credits, a certain type of tax credits, in order to develop the affordable housing.
I also think the question earlier, I think it's very important to understand that these funding mechanisms that you hear about that are going to Wyandanch, that are going to Ronkonkoma, that have come here to Hempstead, what I think it's very important that everybody realize, if they go elsewhere or they come here, it does, the only thing that happens when they come here is it benefits this village. When it goes somewhere else, it's the same tax dollars benefiting some other area of Long Island.
What if the people here aren't here and
it's a bill? Mr. Catherine, please, if you want to say something, please fill out a card. Thank you. What percentage of the buildings will be set aside and made affordable for average and below average income individuals?
That's a great segue from where we just were. So this project on North Main and Bedell is right now conceived at 240 residential units. We're looking to make 90% of them into the tiered mixed income, which can range anywhere from 30% of the median income up to 90% of the median income. And then there's another group that goes up to 120% of the median income, which is called workforce housing. And then there's a percentage of market rate. So the tier will be from one end of the spectrum to the other, all in the same building, to make sure that it's not a segregated social class or economic class in each building. Right. So that's one of the things that was really asked for by New York Communities for Change. They fought for it. They've continued to drive home on it. We hear the message. That's the type of development we want to do. So, you know, those are the types of things. And that's the second part of this. So that is nearly 10% of the total amount studied under SEAKER in that one development. So, and that's just one building, and that's just the second building.
You're only committed to 10% of the whole thing.
I mean, I've asked you, this is my second term. Please, but you know what? You're being disrespectful. Fill out the card. And when you have your form, invite them. Thank you. In the beginning, when this process started, someone asked, where is Ed Scott?
Ed Scott is a good friend of mine. Ed Scott was not a principal of Urban America. Mm-hmm. Urban America is an African American development company. They were our partner from day one. They will be our partner till we are complete with this project. They're based in Dallas, Texas. Ed Scott decided, for whatever reason, it's his business, to move on, to open up his own business. He was never a principal of Urban America, but I can tell you that the principal of Urban America would be happy to meet with this group to show that Urban America was, has been, and always will be a part of this project.
In Brooklyn, at the Court of Appeals, the judge strongly suggested, to be fair to the community, the parcels should not be grouped together, but individually praised. Has this been carried out? We have another question similar in regards to the appraiser that the village has hired. I can tell you the appraiser for the village has not started appraising yet, and Don can explain to you the other part of it.
Well, first of all, I'm not a lawyer, so I don't want to profess to be one and explain to you that there were two processes here. There was what we call a lower court process that the judge in that particular jurisdiction came down and said that the village and the developer did absolutely nothing wrong. There was an appeal that was filed. That appeal process, which basically none of us have anything to do other than wait to see what four judges decided. Four judges ruled absolutely 100% in favor of the lower court decision, upholding what the lower court did. So basically, we sat back and we watched a process take place. And we were very respectful of that process. And that process has spoken. And that process has been concluded. As I said earlier, it is time to move on.
Late summer, early fall, I don't know who we is, but they have a parade festival in Hempstead. The Long Island African American Parade Festival. The parade terminates at the site and where the festival takes place, I believe is Washington One. Since you're taking over most of the property, are we still able to have a parade or a part set aside for the festival?
Is there somebody here who represents that parade that asked the question?
Aye.
So what I will tell you is that it's hard for us to give an answer as to what the logistics and where you go and how you go. I can tell you that I'll be happy to speak to you at the end of this evening, and I'll be happy to hear what you have to say, and I can assure you we will do everything we can to not only make sure the parade happens, but that it happens every year.
Thank you.
Also, I think we'd also love to encourage as many parades, programs, and festivals as possible in the middle of the downtown near the transit hub. So the large parking lots that are still controlled by the Long Island Railroad, and if we could have that activity in the downtown, in the heart of the downtown, on Columbia and Bedell and Jackson, it could help activate those businesses more on the weekends and during those festivals and parades, and bring the community into the downtown. And I think that's very important. The first phase is on the south side of the downtown and not up near the transit. So let's bring the festivals into the heart of the downtown where everybody wants to see the development take place. So if we couldn't start there with the buildings, let's get there with the people. And as we get there with the people, the place will continue to develop, the North Main Street building will go forward, and now we can bring everybody together around them. I'd really strongly encourage all those groups that have them. I know the El Salvadorian Day Parade and Festival also starts in Field 1. To bring that up to the train station and the bus station, I think really would be a great idea. And then you have the transit right there and people can come in and go to these.
It's a three-part question. When did you expect to begin and end Site 1? When did you expect to begin and end Site 2, Washington in front? And part 3, when will Site 2 get presented to the planning board and the zoning board.
I'll tell you who asks me this question every day. Reginald Benjamin. And why? Because when Site 1 begins, then Site 1 puts village residents to work. And what I've always said is better to underpromise and overperform. So what I told Reverend Benjamin was that we were shooting for April, but don't be disappointed if it's May. And I said, get your young men and women ready to go to work. As far as Site 2 is concerned, the first phase was it's a new zoning code. So obviously anything that's new is going to require more time when you're putting the first plan to that process. So the village was very careful in their review, and that's why it took so long. But there are fees that are paid for this process to move in a way that encourages developers and development to happen in this village. So we believe very strongly that Site Plan 2 can begin construction shortly after Site Plan 1 commences. But that all has to do not only with us, but it has to do with the village and their review process. So what we don't want to see here is we don't want to be pushing the village to review something too quickly, knowing full well that the community would like to see something on Main Street happen as quickly as possible. But I can tell you that my feeling is that the village and their reviewers are ready for Site Plan 2, having gone through all the intricacies of Site Plan 1. So I really see it happening in a much quicker manner than Phase 1 did. What was the third part?
It's right here in front of you. And when will Site 2 get presented to the zoning board and the planning board?
Very well. So it's just the planning board. There's no zoning board review because we don't need any variances. So the planning board will hopefully see that by June and be able to review it. But that's not up to us. When the planning board gets it is 100% up to the village engineers and consultants. So once they're satisfied that it's complete, and the downtown advisory board, this is getting into the weeds on the zoning, but we have to be reviewed by the head of the building department, the head of highways, the head of this community benefit committee, the chairman of the planning board, and the head of the CDA, the commissioner of the CDA, and they have to vote whether or not to allow us to go on to the planning board for consideration. So that's a long process, and we have to address all of those concerns, and that's why, you know, the first one did take some time to get through.
I apologize, but I really can't read all of this question, but I would like the person that asked this question to please stand up and give me clarity. It starts out, so in regards to the Washington and Front Street was not part of the
revitalization.
Know what that is. Excuse me?
Revitalization project originally, that's what he said.
Okay.
And yes, then sir. He turned around and now it's a part of it. Washington Street and Front Street.
Okay, you're saying the Washington Street project originally wasn't part of the project.
That's what the gentleman there said.
That's not what I said.
Yes.
No. Okay, we'll give clarity to it.
Well, you can clear it up.
I'm sorry. I never have nor never will say that Washington Street and Front Street was not in the redevelopment project. This was in the redevelopment project when it was conceived in the comprehensive plan years before we were ever even on the radar for the village of Hempstead. So this was always part of it. It was defined as the downtown core. The downtown core was what advised the zoning. And this project was always as part of that plan. So I never said that it wasn't part of the original revitalization.
Wizard Electrical Construction, Manuel Aquino, I apologize if I didn't say it right. He wants to know, Has any project gone out for bidding? Do contractors have to have an office in the village to bid, or do they have to live in the village to bid?
Nothing has actually officially gone out for bid yet. Reginald Benjamin represents the Hobson Business Referral Center, which deals with individuals seeking construction jobs. Crescent, the Crescent Group is dealing with contractors, and what we've done is we realize that there are probably more village residents that would be seeking jobs in terms of meeting the job goals of 25% than there are contractors. If there are enough contractors in Hempstead that would qualify this for this, albeit good. But if not, what the community benefits agreement calls for is that I believe it's any other community in Nassau County with an AMI that does not exceed 110%, 115% of the AMI in the village of Hempstead. So what we did was we said, let's not restrict contractors just to the village of Hempstead and say, well, you don't have enough contractors here to fulfill that quota, so I guess we got to go elsewhere. What we're saying is we've already covered that by saying we will go elsewhere to places in Nassau County with incomes that do not exceed 115% of the AMI for the village of Hempstead.
Just to be clear, AMI is the area median income. So the village of Hempstead is close to $54,000 a year, which, forgive my math, is roughly $63,000 a year. So any census tract in Nassau County that has a median income of around $63,000 a year would be considered after the Hempstead contractors we've gone through the Hempstead contractors as part of it. But if you're not in one of those census tracts and you're not from the village of Hempstead, that doesn't preclude you from having an opportunity to bid on work. This is private work. We can open the bidding process to whomever we want to outside of the regulations of the community benefit policies. So, you know, make yourself known. If you're part of the community here and you want to be part of this, then we're happy to meet you.
Let me just say this on that issue. As it relates to jobs and contracts, I have been working with Crescent. I have a personal stake in this situation. Anybody that is from the minority or local community that are interested in trying to make a bid for those jobs, you need to get in touch with us. You can't stand on the sideline and when it happens say you didn't have a chance. I have direct line, I meet with Crescent all the time. We are on the telephone with one another, and it's my personal drive, if this project go forward, to make sure that we have an opportunity to get contracts and jobs. Now, you need to do your part, make the effort to get in contact with us, and if you need that information, please ask me and I will make it available to you. I will make sure Crescent meet with you. Let me make one other thing clear though. A lot of people say they are contractors and they don't have their paperwork together. You have to make sure you have your paperwork in order. And if you need help with that, you can contact, I believe Shirley Brazley is here, the Office of Minority Affairs, tell you what you need to have to qualify for that. But believe you me, my motive and my every fiber of my being to say, if they build, we should have an opportunity to participate in that economically.
Those are all there. I need clarity on this question. I'll read it, and please, the person that wrote it, please stand up and give us clarity. These new jobs related to the 25% hiring quota, will they be required to hire Hempstead residents? What quota are you referring to?
The new businesses that are coming in, that you expect to come in, there's a 25% quota of new hiring. Are they restricted to Hempstead residents or?
The new hiring quota which we really haven't gotten into yet, because that only happens when you have a building built. And once the building is built, if it's a new building that has no employees in it, then the goal is to have 25% of those people hired for that new building to be village residents. If in the case, as I said earlier, of a company that moves, like, I know there are several people that want to see as much commercial development happen in the village as possible. So do we. But Sean mentioned earlier, people could have built commercial for the last 50 years under the current zone. They haven't, because there hasn't been a market for it. Maybe with what we're doing, there will be a market for it. We want to see as much commercial as possible, because that's a true mixed-use development. So those commercial uses will either be a new company that decides to start up in Hempstead, in which case they will be required to adhere to that, or if a company moves in and decides to take space in an office building that's being built, and they bring 100 employees with them, then we can't ask them to fire 25% of those people. But we can say, and what is on the books, is that any new hires, the goal for those new hires is 25%. So over time, this will become an amazing benefit to the village. But initially, it's there. So what we're saying is we don't want to change it. We were very instrumental in working with the village to make sure it happened. We don't know anywhere else in the country that this has been done, where you not only have a quota for a goal for construction jobs, but you also have a goal for contractors, and you have a goal for permanent jobs. So this means this goes on forever.
With all the vacancies of commercial property in Hempstead, why would businesses move here? And if they don't, does that mean the village residents would have to carry additional vacancies? Whoever wrote this question, could you please stand and give us clarity on it?
We have to carry additional vacancies that the buildings will create when no one moves in, as far as commercial properties, and that means there's no additional taxes. So we, as taxpayers of the village of Hempstead, will now have to carry that additional burden.
We understand that.
We're running into Hempstead, sir.
No,
to run the hell out of here.
And I understand 100% where you're coming from. And let me tell you something. If we're going to put money up and we're going to build buildings, we're going to make sure that those buildings and the buildings that are already here, you have to understand, rising tides lift all boats. So what we're saying is that what the village needs and what the zoning allows for is a proper mix of uses in downtown. Not just one piece of the downtown, but in all of the downtown. So our goal is to not only work with new businesses that come in to new construction, and we're looking to work with existing businesses and make sure that those people who have been here for 20, 30, and 40 years and have bled through the good times and mostly the bad times will get an opportunity to take advantage of this new development. This will be a model development. No displacement. This is what we want to see. We want to see a diverse community. This is what we're about. You have to realize that I am not a Johnny come lately. My family has been here on Long Island for 60 years. Let me tell you what happened in Hempstead back in the 1950s. Just about everybody in their brother and mother went to Monty's Town and Country on Jerusalem Avenue. That's my family. We are rooted in this community. My cousin who passed away from leukemia, there's a Don Monty Memorial Foundation at North Shore Community Hospital. We are rooted in Long Island. So what I'm saying is we are here not only for this development, but I've been here, you know, I say I've been developing for 40 years, and people say, well, gee, you know, you don't look that old, but I say, you know, I started when I was 9. But the truth of the matter is that I have been here a long time, and I'm going nowhere, and I am committed to your community.
But what studies have...
Hold on, Ms. McNeil. Is that part of your first question?
Yes, it is. So
that people, once you build these new buildings in this new area, that businesses are going to be clamoring to get into Hempstead.
Commercial office tenants don't want to come here. So let's be clear about that, okay? We know that. We're not starting with commercial office. What we're starting with is Main Street, residential up by Bedell with businesses on the ground floor. The groups that do want to be here are restaurants, retailers, HR&R block type professional services that take retail businesses, and the healthcare industry. Those groups very much want space here in Hempstead. Now, for future phases, we also have another partner, RXR Realty. RXR Realty is third generation Long Island born and grown and still lives here. They are the largest commercial office owner in the tri-state area. They bring opportunities to bring commercial tenants in that very few other firms have the opportunity to do. They get the call first from the brokers before the business leaves. There are other spaces in Brooklyn or Queens when they've been priced out of the market. So we're trying to bring those resources together, but it's not likely, and none of the first phases that I showed you had commercial office, except for the ground floor offices that are gonna be held by professional services. And so we're with you on that, we understand. But once we build that groundswell of development, those offices will move here. The medical industry will want to move here. There's a lot of interest already, but they have to see things built because none of them believe it's actually going to happen. So once we get things moving, that sparks the interest for the commercial tenants.
Just to explain to everybody what I'm doing, because I see some people watching me, I go through the questions to make sure they're not repetitive, and if they are repetitive, I put them to the side. What percentage, I don't know if I asked this or
but I raised a question with you, and right. You said it was repetitive, and it wasn't.
What's the question you raised?
Reginald Benjamin, and that gentleman right there. You said it was duplicate, and it wasn't.
It was. The question that you asked me, what's your name again, sir?
Armstrong.
The question that you asked me was Mr. Armstrong paid in regards to his construction job?
Was his workers, 17 workers, paid?
Yes.
I'm sorry, sir, but Reginald Benjamin explained that to you here. He asked him personally, were the 17 people paid? That was answered here. I'm sorry if you didn't get it, but it was repetitive. It was answered. But he's here. You can pull him to the side if you didn't get it.
But I'm not here to talk to him. I'm here to talk to him.
But it was answered to you. Reginald Benjamin answered that question.
One of the things, I've got to tell you this.
Answer the mic.
Hold on. Let me just answer that one question. All of these guys, I take them very personal. And the moment that they don't get paid, listen, I'm the first one there. And whatever they say they're going to pay them, I make sure they pay them that. And one thing for sure, the only reason why I used his name, not to get into his business, but because he gave these guys an opportunity to go to work, and many of those guys went from that job to get other jobs. I lifted up his name, not because of his financial issues, but in spite of whatever he was going through. He thought it not robbery to give the people in the village of Hempstead an opportunity to go to work, in which they got paid a decent job, in which they was able to help take care of some of those families. I am not a financial person. I am a person that's concerned about making sure that the people in the village of Hempstead have an opportunity to reap some of the benefit of the economic development that is taking place in this community. And I'm sorry, folks, sometimes I sound so aggressive, but I'm just trying to reflect the desperation of over 1,000 people that need an opportunity to take care of their families. That's all I'm fighting for.
You had him stand and he lost $1 million.
That's not my question.
My question was that.
I can't answer that because I'm not his financial person. I'm not his agent. He didn't pay me to negotiate contracts with him. He didn't pay me to
understand.
Okay, come on. I talked about the jobs. Again, jobs.
What percentage of the apartment buildings will be set aside for affordable? That was asked. Okay, see?
But it is 10%.
The lorry?
Not 90%.
Okay.
The minimum is 10%.
Okay, with the sewers. Bear with me. Okay, someone asked a question in regards to the project being put in place. I don't understand, will there be access to more schools and recreation programs? Because the person who wrote that, could you please give me some more information? Are you asking, what I think they're asking is, are schools gonna be built? Are we gonna have any recreational programs? I believe Don Monty spoke in the beginning that he was working with the school district to institute more programs. Now, is the person asking, what are you asking in regards to the schools? Are schools gonna be built, refurbished? What is the question? Come on.
Well, he answered the part about education, but I still haven't heard anything about Smoothbridge Hill. But with more people coming into the village, our recreation department now is already stressed. Okay, I'd like to know if any of that development will carry recreation programs for the added children that we'll have and for the added, the population itself growing.
Once again, I understand your question, I understand your concerns, and this was all addressed and studied under CEQA, so as I said, I'd be happy to meet with anyone that wants to sit for 1 hour, 1 day, 1 week, 1 month to review that document with us. But what we're really saying here is that at the end of the day, there is a community benefits agreement that's in place. There are prescribed fees. Those fees go in part to the Jobs and Business Referral Center, in part to the new contractors program, and in part to community services. So what we're saying is the more development there is, the more fees get paid. So it's not like somebody comes in here and just gets a building permit and builds a building and goes away. They have to live by the community benefits agreement that goes beyond just jobs and contractors. There's also a portion of those fees that go towards community services. So what we're saying is we'd be happy to sit down with you and anyone else to better explain that. Okay?
When was the RFQ, request for qualifications, and the RFP, request for proposals, issued and made public for the project? Part two of the question, was the offering price, proposed purchase, after he answers the first part of the question, I'll ask whoever wrote this to stand up to give us clarity.
Not quite sure about when the issuance date for the RFP was, but I do believe Sean just informed me that we responded, I believe it was April of 2010. So what we're talking about is, again, this is not something that happened overnight. This is a process that began in 2006. Mm-hmm. It's now 2015. That's 9 years. That's a long time. There were over 300 community meetings that were held, that we took place in. So again, I'm not gonna say that what we don't wanna do is let perfect be the enemy of good. We understand that there are some people here that may not be completely enamored with what is going forward. We understand that, but it is going forward. And you have to understand, we came here tonight. Most developers would say, you know what? We have all our approvals. We don't really need to meet with the people, but that's not our model. Our model is we'll meet with you as long as you want in a civil manner, which I think tonight represents. I think it's a wonderful thing. We're not going anywhere. We will continue to engage with you so long as you want us to. From now to 10 years from now till 20 years from now. That's what we're about. And anybody that questions that, all they have to do is put us through the test. I have made a commitment, and I'll make a commitment here tonight. When this gentleman who has conducted a tremendous meeting tonight calls it quits for tonight, I will stay here. And I will stay here with anyone that wants to ask me additional questions, and I will stay here as long as you want. And I will make myself available as many times as you want. to show you that we are real, that we care about your community, and that we will prove this to you. I don't know how else we can do it other than what we're doing here tonight.
Let me give some clarity. I see Commissioner Spencer looking at me. Don Monte might be here, but he won't be here at the 9 o'clock. Maybe we can do it outside or at the next forum. All right. This question is for President of the School Board Lamont Johnson and Ms. Shelley Brazley. You stated, I get they're talking about Don, you stated that there was an agreement reached between Renaissance and Hempstead Union Free School District. We have the president of the Hempstead Union Free School District among us, and we have Trustee Shelley Brazley.
I don't think I ever said there was an agreement.
Let me answer that question.
Yeah.
Wait, let him say what he said.
Yeah. No. I have offered to meet and have met with the school board on previous occasions and have offered to be a part of whatever happens going forward as a developer that wants to give to the community. But obviously nothing has been decided or determined, nor have I offered anything. It's just that I want everyone to know that as a developer, that I care. And if I'm needed, I'm there.
Just to be clear, I think the word that's been confused is Don said that he made a commitment, not that they had reached an agreement with the board, right? He's committed to doing this, and I think that's where the confusion is coming from.
She knows that wasn't said. We have Trustee Brazley here also. Trustee Brazley, can you come up?
So I guess my question is, have you guys heard from this young man? Yeah, this is at the school board, okay. So you don't run this here, okay?
Wait a minute. See this.
Thank you.
Hello? Hold on one second. Okay. We're not going to do this. We're just going to make it real nice. This is not a school board meeting. This is your meeting.
Right.
Whatever questions you ask me, if it's in my power, I'm going to have the people come up here. But if you need more clarity on this, I'll have the school board with the superintendent up here. But I will allow them to answer those questions. But we don't want to shift this to the school board. But please give as much clarity as you can.
Okay. In recent months, myself, the superintendent, and one other school board trustee member, Don Monte, I believe it was twice, maybe three times, he agreed that he wanted to meet with other trustees. I told Shelley Brazley about that he wanted to meet with her also. And remember I told you that he mistakenly said stuff?
I don't remember.
Yes. Okay. I told you that I spoke to him and that he would want to speak with you also and other trustees. He didn't make any, this is the important thing, nothing is on paper. There wasn't no contract signed. He said verbally that he was willing to help us do what we could do to make Hempstead better in regards to the school district with the graduation rates and programs. He wanted to offer different programs that he thought would help the school district. And he said he was willing to work with us. And he gave us that verbal commitment and a handshake.
Thank you for the clarity.
Okay.
Shelley?
Uh-oh.
I've never met with anyone on these issues, but I would like something in writing. I'm very interested in seeing what kinds of programs that we could work out and we can offer. Our biggest problem in Hempstead is space. So we can have all the programs on the planet, but we have some classes that have 30 to 50 children in them. And I know, according to your study, you keep saying that the people that are coming are empty nesters and young people, but young people eventually marry and have babies. And those babies eventually go to school. And so I'm just very, very concerned. I've lived in Hempstead almost all of my life. I've never seen the conditions that it is in now. I've never seen the trickery and on every level what's going on. And so we do need clarity as to how we're going to educate the children that are not yet born. The children that are already here, It's disgraceful what we're doing to them. We're not offering them any future, any hope. And like the sister said, we don't have park and recreation. We are not offering them what they need in our schools. We don't have the space. And again, we have 30 to 50 children. In the beginning of the year, we had some children that didn't even have desks. They're standing around the walls or sitting on the floor. And to think that people are going to read, because we're in the paper weekly, daily, and to think that people are going to come here with those kinds of disadvantages, and we continue to, it's a genocide. It's a genocide on our people. Black and brown people, it's a genocide. So I'm very much interested in sitting with you, sir. But I'm also interested in getting something in writing. I appreciate your handshake. I'm sure it means a lot. But we need something on paper.
So, well, and thank you. And I applaud your comments also. So my only comment to that is a very simple one. Let's roll up our sleeves, let's meet as soon as we can, and let's get to work.
We don't care if you're Republican, Democrat, the only thing we care about is if you have a concern for Hempstead. The next question, is there gonna be a fee in the parking garages? What materials are being used for the inner wall, meaning are they fire safe? And of people housed in the building, I'll answer that secondly. The question is, are there gonna be fees in the parking garages, and what materials are being used? Mainly are you using asbestos, I think. Who wants to answer that?
Well, we're definitely not using asbestos. All the buildings are gonna be fire rated to whatever New York State code and the village code makes us do. The village has to review all the plans. They review for health and life safety, the fire ratings, the fire door separations, and the materials that need to be used for that building construction typology, whether it's stick wood construction or steel or concrete construction. It all has to be submitted and reviewed by your building department. As far as the construction goes, I hope that answers that question. The other question is the
parking
fees. So there's a parking management plan that was adopted for phase one. So the village charges fees now. The village is going to continue to charge fees for parking. The new parking garages need to replace the parking that's being used by people paying those meters today. So the expectation is that today's conditions, along with the village and the way the village wants to run their parking, will continue. Maybe get better, and then there'll be tenants that have to use the garage. So if you rent an apartment, you have a parking space. If you operate a law firm, you're going to need a certain number of parking spaces, and so that's the reason for this. So the village really sets your parking rates, and they're the ones who set the parking rates now.
This is
going to get what they're getting now, and somebody else.
Catherine, please. This is number three. If you want to say something, put it on the card. The question here's a two-part question. It's a two-part question. I want everybody to understand, when it comes to pilot programs, it has nothing to do with the village of Hempstead. Even though you go to the board meetings and you see them vote on the pilot, it's nothing but ceremonial. That's all it is. It's decided by the town of Hempstead IDA and Nassau County IDA. So that you know, these are the agencies and the institutions that you need to go to in regards to these pilots. Now the question to Renaissance is, are pilots being given?
You already asked.
You already asked?
Yeah.
Okay. Police department, library, fire departments, village hall, town hall, are they slated to be demolished? Where will they be relocated? And I'll ask the second one after that.
Let me ask a question. If it didn't cost the village residents anything, would anybody be opposed to a new village hall? Would anybody be opposed to a new library or some other village property. What we're saying is that under no circumstances would we or could we buy a village property that is now being used, a building that is being used for village purposes, unless the village agreed to an alternative location. And what we're saying is that if the village can get this and not pay any money and have the kind of village hall, a state-of-the-art village hall, that the community could attend meetings in, why would anybody be opposed to that? But the answer is, if not, if the village decides no, and we have sent a letter to the village stating that, it is also in our agreement. We cannot take village property that is presently being used for village purposes, meaning buildings, the buildings, village hall, things of that sort, unless we find a suitable replacement that the village is willing to go along with. Is there anybody that really, am I being clear on that? Could I be any clearer on that? There is no way we're gonna buy village hall unless we can assure the mayors and the trustees that a new village hall will be built first and not paid for by the village nor its residents, or village hall stays where it is.
If I could just ask one question to go along with that. Does anyone here really believe that the mayor would operate the village out of the trunk of his car and the court would hold court on a sidewalk?
But to that point, we've assured in a letter, we've already given the village a letter that has said we can't and we won't. We can't and we won't. I don't know what else about can't and won't. Excuse me? Well,
Catherine, Catherine, what you can do is have a forum, or you can go outside and strip naked, and you can have all the attention you want. You're not getting it anyway. You're being ridiculous. I talked to you about it 2 or 3 times. She's being disrespectful. With approximately 126 officers and officers in the village, how will safety be addressed with the influx of new people and the extra people in the apartment?
I apologize
for what I said, but again, how many times do I have to ask Catherine and Gary to stop showboating? I apologize, so that's it.
But you should know better than this.
Why don't you have a forum so you can have people from both sides of the issue speaking?
So the security has been proposed.
Hold on. If we're going to stay here, we're going to stay here according to the rules that we came here with. Now, the gentleman apologized, and all I'm saying is one thing. There are rules to the road. Either adhere to them, or you will not be talking to us up here.
Right now, I think we're being disrespectful to the person who wrote that question.
Again, Catherine. Have your own forum, do it your way. Stop trying to be seen. Stop trying to be seen and disrespectful to the people here. People have asked questions. People have asked questions and you're stopping them from being, you know what? I'm gonna ask you to be removed in a minute. I'm gonna ask you to be removed. Because you're going too far.
Did you answer that question?
No.
You don't entertain them.
So as part of the site plan submissions, when we go to get the buildings approved, we have to submit security details based on each building. So those security details include descriptions of on-site security, on-site personnel, cameras, two-way speakers, motion sensors, security checkpoints in which the patrols or the security have to check in, doing walking patrols or driving patrols throughout the buildings and the garages. The planning board was very concerned with the safety and security of the existing parking garage that'll be renovated with this first phase. So we had to go through a very long description in the parking management plan about the improvements and the security that'll be put into place. So we'll also work hand in hand with the police department. We'll use live central station monitoring for all of the security systems. And the security people that are on site and the security companies with the patrol cars will be able to use a tablet to have live feeds to the cameras that are surrounding the building in the area. So all of that stuff will go on as we go through each phase. The security that's identified in the site plan will be different depending on where the site is and what the use is.
So with the existing
businesses in the village, excuse me?
That's my question, so can you just give me a little clarity? This one?
Come up so we can hear you.
I asked about the security.
Come up so we can hear you. We can't hear you down there.
Okay. I asked about the security point based on the approximately 120 police officers that patrol the entire village and for whatever crime reasons. But Mike, you said that you would have like your own security patrolling specifically just around the building?
There will be internal security to the overall development, but let me just point out one thing to you. Yes, I absolutely do.
A lot of people don't stay in their buildings.
I absolutely do.
Buildings, and with 120 officers, 24 hours a day, that's
right.
Definitely not enough for an influx.
But, you know, there are a couple of officers here tonight. Not sure what their viewpoint on this would be, but we've done a lot of research around the country. And the interesting part about this research is that what makes communities safer, and I commend the village police force for the job that they're doing. And if we want to help them, certainly in downtown, then the way to help them is not through the lack of economic development, but with economic development. The safest city in the world is the most populous city in the world, New York. And why is it safe? It's safe because they have an excellent police force, as the village does, and they have eyes on the street. They have people that are living there that are actually watching everything that goes on. So the safest areas in the world are those areas in a downtown that have an 18-hour environment where there's constant activity, there's people walking the streets, not in fear, but enjoyment. And that comes from economic development. So if we want to help the great job that the village police force is doing, the way to do it is through economic development, people living in the downtown, so there aren't these corners where people hang out, and there are no people that sometimes you drive through the village of Hempstead at 6:30 at night, you think there was a curfew. That's not safety. Safety comes with development and an excellent police force that the village has right now. So that's where your safety is going to come.
I miss Monty's.
Yes.
It was a great place.
Where?
Monty's.
Oh, you missed it. Okay, well, good. It's not there anymore. It's a CVS.
The next question is, what about existing businesses in the village? Will they have an opportunity to stay? Will they be part of the revitalization? And what about the school and property taxes?
We have offered to meet and have met with every village tenant that has chosen to take advantage. We had an expert come down here on two occasions from Washington, D.C. Her name is Kennedy Smith. She is one of the founders of the Main Street program. We have offered her services to every existing business here to show them how they can take advantage of the economic development that's going to take place. Again, Another commitment that we are making, and another commitment that we will uphold, is to meet with each and every business owner in this village to work with them, because they have paid their dues over the last 30 or 40 years.
I'm trying to get better at this. A question was asked. With the high unemployment in the village of Hempstead, who came up with the 25% of jobs and contracts and not 50% in the surrounding communities, 80 or 90%? What we did is, we have an opportunity to apply for 100% of the jobs. Just because you have been put a special emphasis on 25%, it doesn't mean that disqualified you for the 75%. And I've had several series of talk with Sean in particular, because he's a nut and bolt guy. He says, my goal is not to get the 25%, neither mine's, by the way. He says, my goal is to get as many people as we can employed on this project from the local area. And I'm holding him to that, because it was he who helped me get about 50 guys somewhere else. I know people don't want to believe and accept those things, because everybody have their own agenda. And nobody even, when you disagree with a person, the first thing you should do is go to that individual and talk to them first. And then if you can't come to a conclusion, you deal with it a different way. Who appointed Reginald Benjamin his position when the...
That's my question.
I love you folks. Who appointed Reginald Benjamin his position when their names and their position? I first don't understand that question, but I know that what they did have is a RFP that was put out, and I applied on that RFP, and I was really concerned that they was going to hire outside persons to do the work for the people that live in the village of Hempstead. You imagine how surprised I was that I wound up winning that contract. So they put a bid out, I bid it on it. I and several other people, including the Heavens group, a couple of other groups, and I happened to get the contract to do a consultant. I need you to understand something. I'm a consultant, not an employee. So that should be clear.
Next question.
Excuse me. The question was asked, who employed Reginald, sir, Reverend?
I'm a consultant for the village of Hempstead.
You're a consultant.
To answer your question, Wayne Hall appointed him to his position. Wayne Hall and the village trustees appointed Reverend Benjamin to his position. Wayne Hall. Wayne Hall, Mayor Wayne Hall appointed him to his position. The trustees voted on it, and you have to write it on a card. And the trustees voted on it, and that's how he came to his position.
And when was this?
I was at the meeting. This was last year. Was it
last year?
Last year. It was brought up for consideration, and about 2 months later was when they voted on it.
No, he's
the next question. Can you give a this is to Don Monty. Can you give a ballpark figure of how much money is involved in the licensed contractors and Hempstead African American? I heard you. I'm going to be right there.
No, I give you the paper with the two questions. Let me talk before you tell me to be quiet. I give you the two questions. You didn't answer the second question. My second question was, what about property and school taxes? For us,
because he didn't answer that.
No. He didn't answer that. We pay high taxes for school. We pay high taxes for property.
How this project
will help us to pay lower taxes, school taxes,
okay,
property taxes?
I apologize. I thought he had answered that. I was looking.
No, you didn't answer.
I'm not sure if we're on the same page with the answer, but part of the answer here now: the majority of your tax bill are school taxes. With the property tax cap that the state has put on there, it's the school is under a crunch to make sure they do the most efficient budget, and they have to go through that, but they have to work within those confines. So there's only a certain amount of money that can be allotted to the school budget because it's capped.
above which they can't go. I don't know the details, but I think there's major penalties or it just can't happen. So when a new building comes in and is paying another $1 million in taxes, that automatically has to get spread amongst all the taxpayers in the village because the budget's already set. You can't spend more money because you have more money. And if I'm speaking out of turn, then let me know, but this is how I generally understand.
Let me give it to you in maybe a little different way. If you don't grow, you die. It's as simple as that.
Yes.
So here we are in a village that I feel for all of you because you are paying higher taxes than any village that I know of. So, but let's face this. This is not anything new. This has been. So, better than trying to put blame to why, let's try to come up with a solution how to solve it. So, if you just take it on a very simple level, if you have X number of dollars that you pay in taxes, how are those taxes either going to remain or be reduced? So, let's think about it. How do you reduce taxes? You reduce services. Well, what does that mean? Does that mean go from 120 police officers to 90? Of course not. Does it mean to lay off people here and there? Of course not. What it means is that the problem with the village is that you have 33% of your downtown that is off the tax rolls. So the only way that you can ever come to either stabilizing or lowering your taxes is one way, through economic development, which is what this project represents. So all I'm saying is that all the problems that I've heard here tonight, 90% of them can be solved with responsible economic development. So when you grow, that's how, and especially when you grow in a downtown. When you grow in a downtown, 90% of the taxes generated can fall right to the bottom line, meaning that it's not like, okay, this tax gets spent here, 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 and you end up with nothing. You have a downtown that has a certain amount of infrastructure. You have a consolidation of area for development. This is how you're going to grow. And let me tell you another interesting thing. That, and again, anybody that wants to learn more about this, please, I'd be happy to talk to you. The surrounding single family homes, I can show you areas across the country that have had downtown economic development, where the housing values, when in a 15-minute walk shed of that downtown, have premiums. Premiums. So what I'm saying is there's a lot of misinformation and maybe some lack of information. If there is lack of information, shame on us. But that stops tonight. And what I'm saying is that I need to show everyone here tonight that walks out of here with a certain element of doubt. We need to meet more often, not because I have to, because I don't, because I want to. Remember, I'm not throwing this in anyone's face, but we can all be entitled to our own opinions, but we can't be entitled to our own facts. The fact is that a process has taken place. Whether people in here are for or against that process, it has taken place. It was a democratic process. It was one that was challenged, that was upheld. So what we need to do is be respectful. Respectful is all I'm asking of the process. And part of that respect is for me to say to everyone here tonight, I will make myself available so we can show you how your tax burden can be reduced.
The rentals, how much per month are you looking at? What are the one bedrooms, two bedrooms? What is the projected price on that?
The, That price has yet to be determined. Obviously, we need to complete the appraisal. We think we can do that.
Catch my ass.
But what we need to do is make sure that we're not coming out with numbers too premature. But I can tell you that what we are really looking towards here, and I think everybody should be mindful of phase two, which I think is something that everyone's going to be pleased with. And we just need that support of moving that application forward so that almost in tandem with phase one or shortly thereafter, we can begin that project on Main Street.
Okay. And to be clear, on that project, the state sets the rents. So, you know, it's not something that is determined by the developer. It's determined based on the funding program for tiered mixed income. And I know Communities for Change can give a lot of people information on how that works.
What I'm going to do at this point, because a lot of people really want to talk to Don, and Don wants to talk. If Philly wasn't answered, Don Monte is right here.
I'll stay right here. Until they throw me out.
They're going to throw you out at 9 o'clock. For future reference, the next forum is what you want it to be. Let us know. We'll have the forum. And again, thank you all for coming, for being disrespectful.
So
he is Don. Come ask him. He's right here.
The property that's being sold in the village of Hempstead, will those properties still be owned by the village residents?
No, that's so not how... Excuse me. That's not how economic development works. In other words, your village properties right now are non-revenue producing. They're getting you zero. So what we're saying is any master development that you... I would be happy to give you examples all across. Wine Dance, perfect example. The village, the town of Babylon doesn't own the property. What we're saying is that when a master developer comes in and looks to buy village property and invest in that village property to create economic development, the village doesn't own it anymore.
Why didn't you lease the property for 99 years then?
Well, these are one of those things that this was done in 2012. I don't want to go back to 2012. I think we need to talk about what is today.
Now that you have, I got you. Don is going to sit right here. You can come up because they have to do some cleaning up because they got to be out of here at a certain time. So if you would like, Don, Reverend Benjamin, Lamont, Shelley,
One more thing. Before anyone leaves, if you have to leave and you want to talk to...